case, the next matter to come before the court this morning is Randolph Roth versus the State of Ohio. Both parties will have 15 minutes in which to present your case. If you're the appellate, you wish to reserve any time for rebuttal, let me know and come up to the podium. I'm keeping track of the clock and keep your eyes on the passage of time. We are being visually audibly recorded and posted online, so please try to remain behind the podium as much as possible. We have rendered briefs and we're ready to proceed when you're up.
Okay, may it please the court. I'm Randolph Roth, I'm the appellate in this case. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal, please.
Thank you.
Since you've read the briefs already, I'm not going to bore you with the details. There's a new development. My father, who was a main witness in this case, has recently passed away on January the 18th, 2018. So I'm still in the grieving process. So please, if I happen to read too much, please take that into consideration. During the trial, my father was presented by the prosecution as a feeble, senile man during the proceedings. This is far from the truth of the matter. My dad belonged to a 55 and over active living community. I don't know if you've heard of Del Webb, but he belonged to that, and not only does he exercise regularly, 3 days a week. At one point, he lifted 140 pounds of bench pressing, so he's in very good shape and mentally good shape as well. They had various activities there, cards and things to exercise your mind. So the fact that they were trying to portray him as a feeble, senile old man is totally beyond the truth of the situation. He knew everything that was going on in that situation. He consistently testified, despite vigorous cross-examination by the prosecution. He continually testified to the same thing that he's always testified to. Immediately before the incident, there was a red car facing forward, directly behind him, in the alleged victim's residence, facing forward, immediately before. He also testified that while I was pulling out and before I was pulling out, he looked in all directions. No cars were there. It's not that he didn't see anything, which is what the prosecution was trying to portray. What he saw was no cars coming from any direction. Then I pulled out, and then the next thing he saw was, after the impact, he saw a car, red car, directly behind him, directly behind him. And he also saw, immediately afterwards, the person in the red car move the red car over to the side before the police came. Why is this important that my dad isn't with us anymore? Most of the errors, the remedy is that reversed and acquitted. However, there's some things, for example, manifest weight of the evidence, where you can reverse and have a new trial. Now, for me to have a new trial now without my main witness is going to be very difficult, if not impossible, to have a fair trial. Second of all, so if we have another trial, that's going to be very, very difficult to have. And even if I get sentenced again, it's going to be unfair because he wouldn't be here to testify at my sentencing hearing. By the way, the speedy trial process is for sentencing as well, and as of yet, I haven't been properly sentenced. I haven't been sentenced in open court as the court is obligated to do. During my trial, my father testified and demonstrated the movement of two cars using two matchbox cars. He demonstrated how the cars were impacting how the cars travel, the impact of the car. The property on that, that's included in trail transcript page 120, line 17 through page 123, line 4. During the end of that process, that you'll see in the transcripts, the magistrate promised to describe her findings and conclusions of law, what she observed from the placement of the vehicles that were being placed, but not to take a picture of the cars. And that's page 122, lines 24 through page 123, line 4. She didn't describe, even though she promised to do this, when she did her findings of fact and conclusions of law, she didn't keep her promise, and she didn't describe any of that in the transcripts. Even though I requested findings of fact and conclusions of law, so even after I asked for findings of fact and conclusions of law, I didn't get what you promised to give me, and I asked several other things for findings of fact and conclusions of law, which I really needed to support my objections to the magistrate's decision, and she ignored my request, basically. Upon the defendant's request, the trial court must state his findings of fact. Not only that, the magistrate has yet to announce her findings in open court pursuant to RC 2938.11F. She still hasn't did that in open court. She did that in writing, but nothing in open court. So basically what I'm saying is all these things together, among other things, is structural error. Certain constitutional defects disturb the basic framework within which the trial is conducted and permeate the entire trial from the beginning to the end, so that the trial court cannot reliably serve its function for the determination of guilt and or innocence. And there's several United States Supreme Court decisions to that addresses that. Structural error affects the substantial rights of a criminal defendant, even absent a specific showing that the outcome of the trial would have been different, and require automatic reversal. And there's several United States Supreme Court's decisions that substantiate that. When the constitutional right is involved, the error needs to be harmless beyond a reasonable doubt. And there's also Supreme Court decisions that deal with that. Several things is structural error. A lack of an impartial judge or a biased trial judge, that's clearly structural error. What happened to make the judge biased? The magistrate's failure to preserve my father's demonstrative testimony with the two matchbox cars, which I indicated earlier. The second thing that she did was biased is she admitted disputed evidence, hearsay and expert testimony that I've got into great length in my brief, hearsay from the officer, and the officer testifying as an expert when he shouldn't have been able to testify as an expert. I objected to the hearsay evidence and was overruled. Error is the admission of disputed evidence, the reviewing court must be determined that the remaining evidence alone comprises overwhelming proof of guilt. Another United States Supreme Court that backs that up. If you need the quotes for that, I'd be happy to give it to you. The next one is a total denial of the deprivation of trial counsel to the criminal defendant. That shows bias. Another bias is the erroneous deprivation of the right to counsel of choice. Another U.S. Supreme Court case. Another is a failure to determine whether the defendant's waiver of a right to counsel was informed or obtained a waiver in writing. Another evidence of bias is the misconduct of the,
This was a traffic offense, correct?
This was a minor misdemeanor. It was improper backing.
Okay.
And another structural error is the misconduct of the prosecutor in referring to the fact that the city's evidence was uncontradicted. She said that in her closing statements, and she made an indication of that during trial. Obviously, it is substantially contradicted. It is vastly contradicted. If you cannot believe one instance and believe the other, they directly contradict, especially the placements of the cards when the alleged...
As for your assignment of error on the right to counsel, this being a minor misdemeanor, there was no jail time possible.
There isn't, however, if...
So how does the right to counsel attach?
There is a possibility of going to jail if...
For a minor misdemeanor?
Well, if you don't pay the fine. It's a contempt of court to the jail time.
That's not present in this case, though.
It's not. They're present, but it...
Well, that would be for a contempt.
Yes, but I don't think it distinguishes jail time between contempt and normal jail time.
But you weren't charged with contempt in this case?
No, okay. But I could be.
But you're down 4 minutes and 30 seconds if you want to stop. Now, you can if you wish.
Then I'll rest for now. Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court, counselor, and very sorry for your loss. My name is Toni Morgan, and I'm representing the city of North Ridgeville in this matter today. I'm going to try to, there's six different issues that have been raised, so I'm going to try to speak as quickly as I can. The issue that I want to spend the most time on is the issue regarding the continuance, because this is something that comes up in traffic court with a minor misdemeanor. Someone doesn't wait time. It can come up quite often. Officer unavailability, witness unavailability. So that's the issue I want to start with and spend the most time on. For the state, this case began when we received a phone message from the victim and our witness, her name was Melissa Bitker, that she was on vacation. A neighbor had found a subpoena posted at her house and let her know about it. She had called City Hall and left a message that she would not be returning until June the 4th. State immediately filed a continuance, and a hearing was had on May 31st, and that was the date which had originally been set for trial in this matter. On the 31st, myself and Mr. Roth, I let Mr. Roth know what had happened, why we were seeking the continuance, and the magistrate at that hearing indicated on the record that it was, direct quote, unavailability of a witness. The magistrate then indicated that time would be told between May 31st and June 8th, which was, in the magistrate's words, again a quote, the next available date for trial. Looking at the state's request and analyzing it under 2945.72, we're looking at subsection H, which is a reasonable continuance granted other than upon the accused's own motion. And the Ohio Supreme Court has indicated there are roughly four factors to look at as to whether a continuance of that nature is reasonable. In State v. Lee, forgive me, they indicated that the continuance beyond speedy trial times had to be reasonable as to necessity and purpose. And we believe that in this case, with a key witness unavailable, that was a very necessary request. In a similar case, State v. Elliott, the court continued the trial date beyond the speedy trial time due to the unavailability of a witness, and in that case it was an officer who was on vacation. Also similar to Elliott, in Elliott the court, they were able to get hold of the attorney and he verbally approved it as well. In this instance, Mr. Roth was in court, and when asked if he objected, his answer was no. Another case which is similar factually is State v. Saffel, a high Supreme Court case. That was also a continuance beyond speedy trial time. And again, it was an officer who was on vacation and unavailable. So a continuance beyond speedy trial time because a witness is unavailable is a reasonable request. Another consideration, a second consideration, in deciding whether a contest is reasonable relates to when the request itself was made. High Supreme Court State v. Mincy indicates that that request should be made before the speedy time trial period has expired. In this instant case, the continuance was filed before the set trial date, which had been
and before speedy trial expired, which by state's calculation would have been June 3rd. So again, we complied with that reasonable request. A third factor in determining reasonableness is whether the case is then set as soon as possible. And that comes from SAFL as well. In the instant case, the magistrate specifically used the language that she was setting this trial to the next available date for trial, which was to be June the 8th, and that is just a few days beyond the speedy trial time. And finally, the fourth consideration of reasonableness is noted by the court to be determined on a case-by-case basis. No per se rule of reasonableness should be adopted. This district and State v. King, citing both to Mincy and to SAFL, agreed with that idea, that there was no per se rule as to what constituted reasonableness. It was a case-by-case basis. So reasonable continuance under 294572 subsection H was granted, and this was upon a motion other than the accused. However, the bulk of the delays caused in this case were continuances under 294572, but subsection E, and that is an extension of the speedy trial time by a motion or action made or instituted by the accused. And just a brief timeline: on June the 8th, when the trial had been set, Mr. Roth appeared, Mr. Roth, who I would note is a counselor, and he also appeared with counsel on that date. But on that date, he filed a motion to dismiss. So due to the defendant's motion, the court gave the state a time frame in which to reply, which was done on June 27th, and gave Mr. Roth a time to respond to that, which he did on July 7th, and he supplemented it on July the 8th. On July 28th, the magistrate, taking both of the state and Mr. Roth's information and briefs into account, made her decision. She denied his motion to dismiss, but she also issued findings and conclusions and gave both parties until August the 11th to object to those, to file objections to her findings and conclusions. The magistrate expressed that objection must be ruled on before the magistrate may hear the trial. So the defendant indicated that his intention to object to the findings and conclusions, and he did that on August 11th. State was given a few days, 10 days, to respond to that. That was completed August 22nd. So at that point, the trial was then set for August 23rd. At that time, the defendant came to court on the trial date and attempted to file a motion to respond to the state's May 25th continuance motion, but that was denied by the court, and his objections were specifically overruled at that time. And finally, on the 23rd is when trial was had. I would note that a second issue that's been raised is the sufficiency of the evidence, and to that point, the state presented the testimony of the officer and his observations. When the officer testified, he indicated that when he arrived on the scene, he looked at Bittner's car, and that the damage to that vehicle was basically over the passenger side front wheel well, and the damage to Roth's car was in the back, near the license plate area, near the middle. There was a picture presented in evidence which showed red paint, and that was the color of the victim's car, on the back of Roth's car near the license plate area. Bittner, of course, testified, and she indicated that she backed out of her driveway. She was on the west side of the street and slightly north of the driveway that Mr. Roth had pulled into. They were not perfectly aligned. She backed out of her driveway, her testimony, and was at that point stopped in the road, going from reverse and putting it in drive to go forward. And at that point is when Mr. Roth backed testimony was consistent with the damage that the officer saw and the damage that was in the picture. Both, as Mr. Roth indicated, both he and his father testified, and the state's view of that testimony is that it really didn't contradict anything that was said, the officer's observations or Bidker's testimony or the damage to the vehicle. And at one point, Mr. Roth said, and I quote, "I don't know exactly how that happened." Forgive me, I'm very dry. Third issue, the weight of the evidence. Hawaii Supreme Court in Tompkins has indicated this is a discretionary power, but to be only exercised in very exceptional cases. And the state posits that whether this is analyzed as a strict liability offense, which we believe it is, but even if it's analyzed under criminal negligence, the State v. Varney case was very similar to Roth, and the outcome would still be that he was guilty. Mr. Varney had testified, because he had backed into a vehicle as well, that he simply did not see the vehicle that he hit, but he offered no reason as to why he failed to see it, and that is analogous to the facts in this case. Mr. Roth indicated he didn't see the vehicle behind him, but there was no reason that he gave as to why that might be. So under either standard, strict liability or criminal negligence, we believe he should be found guilty. Fourth issue on a waiver of counsel, as you've indicated, there is no possibility of incarceration here. In addition, the defendant is an attorney and had an attorney with him on two separate occasions on the 11th of August and June the 8th, I believe. The High Supreme Court in Martin had indicated that a written waiver is not a constitutional requirement, and they also indicated in Stewart that there must be some showing of a prejudicial effect. There was none here, and that issue was certainly not raised at the trial court level. Moving on to look at the Ohio Revised Code 2938.11F, which indicates that the magistrate should offer an opinion within not more than 48 hours after submission of the case to her. There are a couple of Ohio Supreme Court cases, Martin and Jones, which indicate that this particular section of the ORC is directory and is not mandatory. And so she has not violated this. This is not a reason to overturn the case or grant the defendant's appeal. This is merely directory language, not mandatory. And given the massive caseload, there's nothing out of the ordinary about the time frame of this particular case. And finally, as far as Criminal Rule 43A goes, that the defendant should be present during sentencing, yes, he should be present during sentencing, and if he needs to be resentenced, that is the remedy. It doesn't invalidate the case. It merely sends it back to that, so that can be exercised and he can be resentenced in front of the magistrate. And I would like to just briefly add on the issue of bias, the appellant's brief indicated that there was bias, but there was just a bare allegation of that. Today is the first time that there's been any specifics, alleged specifics offered. But I would note that simply overruling an objection happens in court all the time, and that's no indication of bias. And again, this is the first time anything was alleged that was specific at all. Thank you.
So, Rob, you have 4 minutes and 13 seconds.
Let me first state that strict compliance is necessary with the speedy trial statutes at any stage of the speedy trial. And I briefed that in length that, you know, speedy trial should be strictly complied with.
Sir, how would you do that if you filed objections to the magistrate's decision, so there need to be some ruling on that, so wouldn't that necessarily extend the time out?
Yeah, it would extend, but the rule is that it should extend only for the reasonable amount of time that they need, and there was a time frame five dates that could have been available after the ruling was, the decision was made on that issue. She could have, and the court was open for hearings on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So she could have had it on July the 28th, which is a Thursday, August the 2nd, which was a Tuesday, August the 3rd, which was a Wednesday, August the 4th was a Thursday, and August 9th was a Tuesday. Any of those days were available. She didn't need to push it up until the next day. All those days were available.
And everyone was available on every one of those days, or was there anybody who wasn't available on any of those?
As far as I know, everybody was available.
Is there something in the record that would show that?
There's nothing that shows that anybody is not available.
Is 7 days an unreasonable delay?
It is for, under the strict compliance, and again, it's only what's necessary for her to rule on the whatever I filed, I can't remember. I filed objections to the magistrate's decision. No, that was a motion prior to that.
Motion dismissed.
Yeah, motion dismissed.
That was.
After she answered the motion to dismiss, then she should have said something right away at the first meeting on Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday, and she didn't.
Did you have an opportunity to respond to their motion in opposition to your motion to dismiss?
I did. Everybody responded to that. She ruled on it, yet she still waited five extra days, which was available. As far as that, the first witness that was on vacation was available from June the 4th to June the 8th, and she didn't reschedule until the 8th. So she left all that time open when we could have had a hearing.
Well, the presumption would be that she has nothing else to do during those intervening days, right, except schedule a hearing.
Well, I mean, it indicates in the record that the court's available every Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. I mean, not Friday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So I'm assuming that the court's open all those days every week because it says so.
Well, you did not object to the new date, did you?
I continually, every time I went there, I said I'm now waiving speedy trial rights. And as far as
that, when she gave you the date, approximately 1 week later, did you object to the court setting that date for your trial?
No, but I told on page 4 of my brief, it basically says that do you have any objection to the, and then it was cut off, and I say no, I just like to clear things up, and then there was inaudible noise. And that's where I was telling her I want to make it very clear that I'm not waiving my speedy trial rights. But apparently that didn't come up on the transcripts. And then, but there's a difference between, you know, just standing there passively because, you know, you want to keep respect for the judge.
But there is also a difference in not objecting, the record before us doesn't show an objection. You didn't supplement the record in this case, did you?
I objected at every level.
All right. Well, we will take the matter under advisement. You are out of time, sir, for today. But we will take the matter under advisement, and we will issue a written decision, which will be posted to our website and mailed to both sides.
Okay. Thank you, Your Honor.